So because most of my clients have to deal with complex mechanical and pathological issues, I often collaborate with other practitioners such as physiotherapists, chiropractors, massage therapists, or osteopaths, or physicians who are pain specialists, or physiatrists. Over the past several years, it became clear to me that integrating movement training strategies into clinical practices is important because both the healthcare and the fitness communities have been under increasing pressure to help people adopt healthier movement behavior while at the same time preventing them from getting back into their compensatory behavioral patterns. We have been using so-called movement correction strategies to achieve this goal. On the surface, it may appear to focus on improving the mechanical aspects of movement, but at a deeper level, the ultimate goal is to improve how the central nervous system perceives and organizes the movement. And during the past decade, we have seen tremendous amount of neuroscientific discoveries which can be used to advance the current movement correction strategies. I have been fortunate enough to have been involved in some of research on sensory motor neuroscience and have been teaching subjects dealing with motor control for 4 years at Simon Fraser University and University of Saskatchewan in Canada before I began my practice as a clinical kinesiologist. In doing this work, I hoped to contribute to collective effort to translate the neuroscientific knowledge into the field of movement training. For today's presentation, I will review the current understanding of how the central nervous system induces human motor adaptation. Then I will discuss how we can use this knowledge to advance the current strategies for movement training. Before we talk about the scientific theories behind the human motor adaptation, let's think about the following situation. You borrowed a French computer and found out that the mouse setting is different than what you're used to. It doesn't even have a scroll wheel. And the mouse cursor moves much faster than you expected, making it difficult for you to accurately control the mouse cursor. What causes the resulting error in this case? The computer? Probably not. Our incorrect prediction regarding how much the mouse cursor would move relative to our arm movement is what's causing the error. Luckily, it doesn't take too much time for us to adjust both our prediction and our arm movement so that we can regain the accurate control of the mouse cursor. In other words, we're able to adapt to the demand from the new environment. So, we can say that adaptation is the process of reshaping both our prediction and motor planning so that we can minimize the mismatch between our prediction and the actual consequences. The similar concept was proposed as the theory of the internal model by a Scottish psychologist, Kenneth Craik, in 1943. According to Craik, our brain contains a small-scale model of the external reality that works like a simulator that predicts the consequences of different actions before they actually occur. And our daily activities provide this simulator opportunities to compare its prediction regarding what it would happen with the actual consequences. And based on this comparison, this internal external model continuously evolves so that our prediction becomes accurate enough to allow us to interact with ever-changing environment in a safer and more competent manner. Now, as a result of other neuroscientific discoveries, it became even clearer that what Craig called the internal model actually exists in our brain. Now we're at the stage where we can actually map out the regions of the brain for this internal model. For example, as we intend to move, the motor cortex sends a copy of the motor commands that has the motor planning to other regions of the brain before the movement actually occurs. And the brain regions that receive this copy of the motor commands work like the predictor. One representative regions of the brain used for the prediction is posterior parietal cortex, which is actually a sensory cortex. Its basic role is to integrate the various sensory information, such as vision, touch, joint position sense, or body equilibrium. So we are able to predict upcoming sensory feedback that would follow the movement. That is why such prediction is often called sensory prediction. And when there is a mismatch between the sensory prediction and the actual consequences, we call that there is a sensory prediction error. And how is the error detected then? The sensory prediction, the neural signal regarding the sensory prediction is sent to other regions of the brain that are responsible for comparing the actual versus predicted sensory information. One representative brain region for the comparison is cerebellum, which seems to be strategically positioned to work like a middleman between our cerebrum and the spinal cord. The information regarding the sensory prediction error is then fed back into the circuits within the cerebrum so that our prediction can be constantly calibrated and, if necessary, the motor planning itself. It is important to note that the studies on the cats and monkeys, not on the humans, have provided direct evidence for such a structure arrangement of the internal model. Nevertheless, many other behavioral studies on the human clinical population have strongly suggested that similar structural arrangement for the internal model actually exists in our brain. Now, the theory of the internal model tells us that important role of the human motor adaptation is to ensure our very survival. However, it seems like that the modern society is suffering from the cost of the adaptation rather than truly enjoying the benefit of the adaptation. Postural maladaptation, coming from too much sitting, is one of the very common examples. Interestingly, trying to sit correctly, based on our understanding regarding biomechanically correct posture, doesn't seem to help that much with preventing this unideal or unwanted adaptation as long as we were sitting. Then I suppose we need to ask if it is even possible to choose not to adapt when our environment calls for adaptation. Let me talk about a research that tells us that adaptation is so ingrained to our brain and we may not have conscious control over it. Box A describes a research experiment that showed a typical adaptation. So the participants were asked to reach to a green target using the cursor on the screen, represented their occluded hand. Their moving hand was hidden under the table, and the cursor on the screen represented the location of the sensor attached to their finger. The sensor was manipulated so that the movement of the cursor was shifted 30 degrees counterclockwise relative to the actual hand movement. As expected, the participants missed the target 30 degrees counterclockwise at first, But as they repeat the trials more and more, they eventually learn to aim 30 degrees clockwise to hit the target, which is also expected. So that's the typical adaptation pattern. Now let's talk about the box B. The researchers replicated the research that I talked about in box A on different participants, but this time they asked the participants to deliberately aim 30 degrees clockwise because the sensor is manipulated. Then you can hit the target. No further change is necessary. This explicit strategy worked really well at first. Participants were able to hit the target accurately, but as they repeat the trials, they started missing the target further and further clockwise, and they didn't understand why it was happening. Some even thought that the researchers had lied to them. What was going on? The only explanation to this is that the adaptation happened unintentionally. And the same unintentional adaptation occurred in other studies using different types of adaptation, where the reach trajectory of the participants were shifted through the direct force to the hand, not the visual manipulation. So it was eventually defined that the motor adaptation is implicit, meaning that it is automatic, it is unintentional, and occurs without one's awareness. What drives such an implicit adaptation then? The researchers replicated this study again, but this time they recruited the patients with cerebellar deficits. The result was completely different than that of the studies on the healthy population. First, the box A shows that without being given the explicit strategy, the patients missed the target 30 degrees counterclockwise consistently, meaning that the typical adaptation did not occur. In box B, when the explicit strategy was given, so meaning that they actually asked the patients to deliberate aim 30 degrees clockwise, they were able to hit the target consistently throughout the trial, meaning that the implicit adaptation did not occur and the explicit strategy dominated. What are the implications then? If we relate this back to the mechanism of the internal model, cerebellum is what detects the mismatch between the expected cursor location and the actual cursor location, which is essentially the sensor prediction error. So the result indicates that the mechanism behind the implicit motor adaptation is the sensor prediction error. Naturally, we can argue that we can facilitate motor adaptation if we can create a certain sensory prediction error for an individual. There are currently devices and tools available to alter sensory information. For example, there is prism bubble that shifts our visual field to a certain direction. A split belt treadmill that creates asymmetrical demands to our gait, and a virtual reality system that creates a discrepancy between perceived and actual motion. I think these devices and tools can be also used to help people adapt towards a certain mechanical behavior of the joints. For example, it was anecdotally observed during an experiment on sensory motor learning at a Simon Fraser University sensory motor neuroscience lab that the osteokinematic behavior of the hips changes when we ask the participants to try to walk straight while wearing a prism goggle. And many participants showed similar patterns of change. And I would love to see more research on the effect of the sensory modification on the biomechanics of the movement. Now, why is it important to know that the adaptation is implicit? We often explain our clients or patients how to move. We give the information regarding the muscle activation or joint positioning, hoping that it would facilitate an adaptation towards a correct movement mechanics. However, we have a bit of a dilemma here now. As we just learned that, such explicit strategy doesn't have much control over implicit adaptation, but we still need to use some verbal instructions or cueing to help people to understand what we hope to achieve. Is there a proper way of using those verbal instructions and cueing? Well, the author of the book, Attention and Motor Skill Learning, Professor Gabrielle Wolf from the University of Nevada and her research team have suggested that the verbal instructions and cueing that draw conscious attention to the internal process of movement, such as muscle activation or joint positioning, can be disruptive to the implicit motor control process. They have suggested that it would be more effective to use external cues that draw attention to expected movement outcomes or movement goals. And their suggestion was well supported by other research on motor skill learning of the novice athletes. Examples of the internal cues that can be disruptive to the implicit motor control process can be push your hips back, activate your glutes in case of the squat exercise. Examples of external cues can be sit back into an imaginary chair or push the ground to stand up. Now, there has been a suggestion that explaining the internal process of movement before the practice can help people to understand the context of the practice. So what I'm saying is that I'm not saying internal cues are bad, external cues are good, but it is certainly worth recognizing that there is an impact on how we say and what we say on the implicit and natural process of adaptation. Now let's look at an example of how we are currently using tools to help people improve the movement mechanics. If an individual habitually shows medial collapse of the knee when trying to load the body weight onto one leg, we can use a TheraBand that actually pulls the knee even more medially so that the person can reactively push against the TheraBand, thereby correcting this misalignment. This method, commonly known as the reactive neuromuscular training, sometimes even works like a magic because it shows the immediate improvement of the alignment of the knee. However, such benefit doesn't translate easily to the movement without the TheraBand, indicating that the immediate improvement is likely to be a temporary adaptation specific to the TheraBand. In response to the TheraBand, our brain somehow come up with the motor command that is ideal for controlling our own limb. What we really hope is for the person to achieve the same motor command without having to rely on the TheraBand. Then how can we maximize this potential while still using the TheraBand for the training? To do so, we need to understand a little bit more about how our central nervous system generates the motor command. A motor command is a selective activation of the neuronal cells within the motor cortex based on central nervous system's estimation regarding how much force is needed to be able to induce a desired kinematic change of the body, such as movement angle, trajectory, distance, acceleration. The effect of the force production on the kinematic changes of the body is defined as body dynamics or dynamic response of the body. This body dynamics can be cognitively understood, symbolized as the mathematical formula on the screen. It is important to understand that there are variables that would change the dynamic response of the body given the same amount of force. Examples of these variables are segment length or weight that needs to be moved, or extensibility of our soft tissues. And we can appreciate that the value of these variables often go through change as we use different manual tools, such as a hammer or a tennis racket. In addition, growth, development, the aging process, or injuries can often affect the changes of these variables. If we have to measure these variables every time that they go through change, then the process of estimating the right amount of force will be very slow, and it will be impossible for us to achieve precise and timely motor control. It was suggested that the implicit motor adaptation represents the central nervous system's effort to overcome its own limitations regarding the delayed cognitive understanding of the body dynamics. For example, constant calibration and the instantaneous update of the motor commands automatically accounts for the changes of the important variables such as segment length, weight, or extensibility of the soft tissues. How are we doing? Did I lose anybody here? It's good?
Okay.
Importantly, it was also suggested that continuation of the implicit motor adaptation allows our central nervous system form certain neuronal model of the task-specific body dynamics, which works like a bit of an implicit understanding of the task, different than cognitive understanding of the movement. And such neuronal model of the body dynamics can be expressed as the neuronal representation within the motor cortex. For example, in vivo studies on the primates have found that the motor cortex is capable of forming certain directional preferences within the neuronal cells in the motor cortex after repeating certain tasks many times. And it was also argued that such directional preferences can be used as a convenient lookup table to form muscle synergy to control our own limb. So if we relate this to the TheraBand exercise that I was talking about, what we ultimately want to achieve is to update the neuronal model of the body dynamics, as it can update the synergistic muscle activation of how we move our body limb without having to rely on the tools or equipment. And how can we maximize the potential for this while we still use the TheraBand? To do so, it is important to understand that when central nervous system recognizes that there is a movement error, it needs to estimate the sources of the error. The sources of the error can be extrinsic, such as equipment used or environmental conditions. Or it can be intrinsic, such as muscle activation, timing, or intensity. If the central nervous system attributes the error to the extrinsic sources, it makes adjustments specific to the context specific extrinsic factors, equipment, or environmental conditions. But if it determines that the error is coming from the intrinsic sources, it tries to update the neuronal model of the body dynamics. It is well known that there is always a certain degree of error coming from the intrinsic sources, even for a simple movement like reaching, because there is always a certain degree of error expected in the process of sending the neural signal from the brain to the muscles and convert the signal into muscle activation, which neuroscientists often call motor noise. So we can appreciate that in our daily environment, both the intrinsic and the extrinsic factors constantly affect our movement. Therefore, instead of treating the contribution from intrinsic and extrinsic sources in all or nothing manner, the central nervous system has to weigh the relative extent of the contribution from intrinsic and extrinsic sources and find a way to combine them in an optimal way. It was suggested that central nervous system can evaluate the relative extent of the contribution coming from intrinsic versus extrinsic sources of the error based on the variability of each component experienced. Based on this evaluation, central nervous system then prioritizes the adaptation towards less variable factor, which makes sense because less variability also means more predictability, and our brain likes to predict. The research group who suggested this principle used a force field adaptation protocol where participants reached to a target while holding a robot handle that generated force which deviated their reach trajectory to a certain direction, which is somewhat similar to the TheraBand exercise that we're currently using. What does the principle regarding the relationship between the variability and the adaptation tells us about the current method of corrective exercise? Well, the exercises shown on the screen are often used to promote healthy upward rotation of our shoulder blade. In movement rehabilitation settings, there are usually two aims for these exercises. One is to facilitate the inhibited muscles, and another is to improve muscular strength endurance. So the programming of these exercises should address both goals. However, arguably, in most cases, we have been programming these exercises suitable more for improving the muscular strength endurance rather than facilitating the inhibited muscles. For example, it calls for 15 to 20 repetition using the fixed amount of weight or resistance, 3 or 4 sets, until we fatigue, which is based on the principle of overloading that induces the physiological adaptation of our neuromuscular system. However, taking into account of what we now know, we can appreciate that facilitating the inhibited muscles would require different mechanism than just physiological adaptation. It requires motor adaptation that allows our central nervous system to update the neuronal model of the body dynamics. As we discussed in the previous slide, using the variable forces rather than consistent forces would be more beneficial to achieve such a benefit. Therefore, I would like to suggest considering more options that can provide variable forces compared to traditional weight or weight plate based equipment, such as TheraBand. Also, manual perturbation is a very effective way of changing the resistance after each repetition. In addition, pneumatic or hydraulic resistance device can provide a convenient way of varying the forces, which are also measurable. So, today I talked about the neuroscientific principles of human motor adaptation, which can be summarized as the following. First, sensory motor adaptation occurs unintentionally and automatically due to the embedded function of the internal model to reduce the sensor prediction error. Therefore, we have minimal cognitive control over it. Second, the central nervous system is capable of differentiating between the predictable and non-predictable factors that affect the movement based on the variability of each factor experienced. Then, the central nervous system prioritizes the adaptation towards a less variable factor as it is more predictable. As for the implication, I would like to suggest the following take-home messages. First, creating a sensor prediction error can be an effective way of tapping into brain's mechanism to facilitate a motor adaptation towards certain mechanical behavior, rather than completely relying on verbal cues or instructions. Second, if we need to use the verbal instructions and cues, we need to appreciate that these have impact on implicit and natural process of adaptation. Third, when using the external forces to induce an adaptation, motor adaptation, using the variable forces rather than consistent forces would maximize the benefit of updating the neuronal model of body dynamics that are transferable to other contexts. These are the references by the subject, and these are the resources where you can get the articles from. And we have talked about sharing our presentation. If you are on LinkedIn, I am going to upload the PDF file version of this presentation, where you can also find another version that explains experimental procedure and interpretation of data for the research evidence that I talked about a little bit more in detail. And you can also find me on Facebook, and you can email me. I would love to share ideas and learn from each other. And thank you very much for listening patiently. And I would love to answer any questions that you may have.
And first off, I want to thank you for taking a subject that can try and tie people into knots, making it very accessible. Mm-hmm. I appreciate your efforts to make it concrete and real.
Thank you.
I guess my question is, could this not be a model, an idea that as far as explanation for the repeated nature of practice and in different conditions?
Oh yes.
This should be not only youth, but could you not see it being in place for geriatric populations?
Oh yeah, definitely. Yeah. And I think that this presentation is still kinda in the realm of the neuroscience, and I mean I try to make it applicable, but I can really sense that it's still very kind of a academic. But the reason why I started to learn about this is because there was a moment that I felt like the role of the trainers or therapists is to provide a right type of environment that people can actually experience the movement challenges and also success or failure, so that their own perception of the movement would change based on their own level, rather than we try to dictate people, this is how you should move. No? So yeah, definitely. Yeah, geriatric population, youth, athletes.
Thank you.
Did I answer your question?
I liked that you obviously can use this with your corrective exercise type situation. And I could even see how, you know, following a biomechanical analysis, if we discovered that, say, someone's baseball swing is consistently off, that we could even use, say, your TheraBand type situation to adjust the swing, you know, depending on where we hook the band, to modify the motor neuron and sensory and adjust that motor swing, you know. So how we perceive it, consistently get what we want, slowly take the band away, scaffolding, and we're back to where we need to be.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, yeah. And I think it's important that the practitioners like you try to apply this. Because if you think about the experiments that I talked about, these are all non-weight-bearing reaching movements. We still are facing the limitations regarding the application to the practice. But if we want to bring that idea to the research setting, it's really hard because of all the confounding variables. But that doesn't mean that we shouldn't try. And I think that the actual practical setting that you guys are working at is an excellent environment to try and actually keep feeding the researchers with the anecdotal evidence so that they are motivated to actually look at this in more holistic movement setting.
Yeah.